Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to Meadow United Methodist Church, 768 Summit Road, here in Eden, North Carolina. It's great to have you with us today as we not only worship God and study His holy word and fellowship together, but we're also paying honor to Veterans Day. I know that was earlier this past week, but this was the closest day to do that. So we're very thankful for that. For our announcements today, I've been in contact with the homeless shelter, and they are going to be operating this year. Normally, I think they probably start in December. But anyway, they need some help, as we've helped the last several years, that they can use Clorox products, paper products, forks, spoons, paper towels, toilet paper, just similar things like we've provided for the last. We're going to collect all of the rest of November and December, and we'll take what we collect to them at the end of December. So if you go to the grocery store, and I know everything has gone up in price, but look and see if there's something that you could provide. So, because we are so blessed that we have shelter and homes and so forth. And there are a number of people that are homeless these days. So I do encourage you to help with that. Reach out to other people. Use your telephones and send them text messages and cards and so forth, and just let them know that we're thinking about them. Bingo every Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock. Please come and join us. We have a good time. And it's also a mission. It's not just for our people here at this church. We have people from other churches, and we have people that come who are unchurched. So this is an opportunity for us to reach out into the community and provide something that they want, and it gives us an example to just show our care and our love for other people. We need bingo prizes for the nursing home. We are co-sponsoring a blood drive with Spray United Methodist Church. It's going to be held at Spray United Methodist Church because their facilities in the fellowship hall are larger than ours, and they're able to spread out more. This is going to be on November the 29th. The blood drive is in memory of Angela Boone. I put a flyer on the doors you came in. I'll be putting some out in the community. The blood drive is from 2:30 in the afternoon until 6:30 that evening. So you may not be able to donate blood, but you might know somebody who can. Please encourage them. I'm hoping by having this in memory of Angela that's going to encourage some other people that normally would not come and donate to do so. We did the same thing a couple of years ago for her mom when she passed. Booster shots are available, so if you haven't had your booster shot, I can encourage you to think about that. If you have a health or other concern, please share. And I'll share a phone call I got early this morning, which I didn't know anything about, and if they hadn't called me, I wouldn't have known anything about their need. Our Samaritan shoe boxes are today. I'll carry them tomorrow. I've got one more at my house I need to put together. I brought one today, but we've got another one. We're going to have 12 shoe boxes. That's great. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'll carry these down to First Presbyterian Church tomorrow, and they will collect hundreds of them, and then they will actually physically carry them to Charlotte. I assume that's where they're going this year. And at that point, they have to double check the boxes, make sure we follow directions, and then they'll be, you know, putting some type of containers or whatever, and before long they'll be on their way around the world. So it's a wonderful thing to do. Next Sunday we're going to celebrate Thanksgiving. So please think about things that you are thankful for. I may ask for some volunteers to tell us that next week. Two Sundays from today is the first Sunday of Advent. That's November the 28th. And with Nick's help, we'll have our Christmas tree over here at the side. And we will have our Chrismon service on the 28th. So I look forward to that. That's one of my favorite services of the entire year. I've already mentioned the homeless shelter. Do we have other announcements that we want to share this morning? Do we have any birthdays? Anniversaries? I'm going to ask those people that are able to stand to do so for our national anthem. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Second, we'll pledge to our Christian flag. Again, attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood uniting all Christians in service and love. And then for the Bible. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word, and will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart, that I may not sin against God. If you'll turn in your hymn book, please. 696, America the Beautiful.
Amber waves of rain.
call to worship. This is the Lord, the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
The Lord is God, and he has given us light.
You may be seated. If you'll turn in your hymn book again to number 697. A mirror, 697. Specific individual church. Well, we don't have any little kids today, so we will move on to thinking about Veterans Day. You know, Veterans Day, a lot of people get it mixed up. That they get mixed up Memorial Day and Veterans Day. Memorial Day is the day that we remember all of those people that actually died in service to our country. Veterans Day is when we lift up every single person that has served in any part of our armed forces. So today is the day we're lifting those people up that have given sacrifice from their own daily lives by going and being a part of protecting our country and working for our country. It started as Armistice Day a long time ago, and the reason that we think about November the 11th as Veterans Day, it goes back to the end of World War I, and we think about the war actually ended. The 11th hour, the 11th day, and the 11th month, and the year was 1918. So that's the reason we celebrate Veterans Day on November the 11th. And again, it was called Armistice Day until 1954, when they changed the name Armistice Day to become Veterans Day. I got an email this week, one email, it's a text, from one of our members. She's not able to be here today, but Janice Denny said she thought this summarized what Veterans Day was pretty good, and I agree with her. Please listen, I don't know who wrote it. I even searched on the internet and couldn't find a writer, an author. But what is a veteran? A veteran, whether active, duty, discharged, retired, or reserve, is someone at one point in their life wrote a blank check made payable to the United States of America for an amount of up to including their life. This is honor. And these are way too many people in the country today who no longer understand this fact that they wrote that blank check, and a number of them made the total sacrifice of giving up their lives. I appreciate Janice sharing with me and then me with you as we think about that. I offered a lot of people poppies this morning. Poppies go all the way back to May of 1915. And there was a lot of red poppies that grew over in the area where this war was so awful. Of course, the war is awful, but the areas were just totally destroyed, the soil just laid waste, and all of a sudden the next year, in some of these places, they found the most beautiful red flowers. And they were poppies. Now, poppies are not as big as the ones that I printed out and cut out last night. It's about a fourth this size. But it's a reminder that the military and people that are serving and lifting up the military associate poppies with Veterans Day. And there's a poem that was written, and it was written by Major John M. McCrae, entitled In Flanders Fields. It goes like this. In Flanders Fields the poppies blow across the rows and row of crosses that mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard among the guns below. We are dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders Fields. Take up our quarrel with a foe. To you from falling hands we throw. The torch, be yours to hold it high. If you break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep though poppies grow in Flanders Field. I would like to play a CD. It's entitled Salute to the Troops. And I'll call out the military. I'm sure you'll recognize the songs, but I'll call out which area of our national defense they're representing. And if you happen to have served in this branch of service, please stand while that particular song is playing.
Thank you.
give our military a round of applause. We are thankful, and even if it's, though it's after Veterans Day right now, if you happen to see a veteran, please tell them thank you, because we do have freedoms, and these freedoms are not lasting forever without people making sacrifices. And then there's things that you and I, even if we're not in the military, can do to help protect our freedoms.
Brother Wayne?
Yes, sir.
I'd like to stand up for my dad.
Okay.
My dad was born in 1890. And he served in the Army and the Navy. He got honorable discharges from both branches of service. I've never been in service. And I had a brother who fought in Africa with the U.S. Army. And he got an honorable discharge from that also. And I'm proud of both of them for what they're doing. And I'm thankful that I've never had to serve. I registered when I was 18, but I never was called up. Thanks a bunch for letting me say all that.
Well, we appreciate. My dad was also in the Coast Guard, and you know there's many people around that have served, and we've all got relatives and friends and you know people. I love genealogy. I can go all the way back to the American Revolution. With some of my relatives, and even way back beyond that. But and it is important that we remember the people that served, because they made a difference for us today. Thank you. How has God blessed you this past week?
It's like it done me. The Lord sure helped me get through that. I was allergic to something.
Mine lasted 2 days. How long did yours?
Mine lasted from Tuesday, and I'm just getting over it.
Okay, yours lasted longer than mine. Okay, somebody else was saying something. God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Amen. Nick, if you would come up and share with us, please.
Thank you.
you, Nick. That's a very patriotic song, and so it's a good song that we often sing here within the church. Thank you. Our responsive reading is found on page 762. 762. And it continues on the next page. Please join with me. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have lifted me up and did not let my foes rejoice over me.
O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you healed me.
O Lord, you brought up my soul from Sheol.
Restore me to life from among those gone down to the pit.
Sing praises to the Lord, O his faithful ones, and give thanks to his holy name.
Surely the Lord's anger is but for a moment. The Lord's favor is for a lifetime.
Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning.
As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved.
By your favor, O Lord, you had established me as a strong mountain.
You hide your face, I was dismayed.
To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication.
What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit?
Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness?
Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper.
You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have loosed my sackcloth and girded me with sadness or gladness, that my soul may praise you and not be silent.
O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever.
She called me this morning and said she wasn't doing well and that she would be having surgery at our local hospital on November the 30th. She also shared with me that Haley has just turned 20 on October the 27th. That doesn't seem possible. And that Kay seems to be doing pretty good. So certainly want to keep Rhonda in our prayers. Deborah Donovan, Rylan Janice Denny, Tabitha Godwin, Our Nation, Joan Witt, David Moore, Don Warren, Lori Goins, Lloyd Saunders, Jennifer Shelton, Bob Boone. I saw Bob this week and he was doing fair at Bryan Center. Judy and Billy Morris, members and attenders that aren't able to be with us today. Our schools, Dwight Lucas, Martha Eanes, Austin Joyce. Do we have others that we want to add to our prayer list or update our prayer list?
Wayne, you can move Jennifer Shelton to unspoken. She's doing much better.
Okay, wonderful. Praise the Lord. Others? Let us pause for our meditation and our prayer.
Thank you.
Father, as we come to you today, we just thank you for all the blessings that you send our way. We don't deserve them, and yet because of your love and your grace and your mercy, you continually bless us. Be with those that are sick. Remove their pain. Allow healing to occur. Strengthen them. Be with their families, their nurses, their doctors, their caregivers, whoever that might be. Be with those that are grieving. Grant them peace and comfort. And Lord, there's all kind of problems around us. We just ask that you be with each of these concerns and bring resolution. Strengthen people's faith in you. Help them, to all of us, to be obedient to your will. Lord, be with our nation. There's so much going on that is not right. And Lord, we just ask that our nation return to you. Help us to once again be a nation under God. Lord, be with our schools. Be with our students, parents, teachers, administrators, and staff, and school boards. Lord, we ask that you be with the leaders at all levels of government. Help them to remember that we put them there and they're working for us. Lord, be with this church and all churches. Help us to reach out to others, to share God's love and care, and to make disciples. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our offering plate is in the aisle for those that would like to share with the church. And for those watching our DVDs on YouTube, you could send a gift to our church through Diane Carter, our church treasurer. Nick, if you would come up and share with us, please.
There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless you. we love this land. God bless the USA.
Thank you, Nick, and we certainly do pray that God will bless the USA. Our scripture today comes from Hebrews 10, verses 11 through 25, and I double-checked my scripture today to make sure that I had the correct scripture, and I do. Again, I'm reading from Hebrews, beginning with chapter 10, verse 11. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down to the right hand of God. From henceforth, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of those is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us, through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one other to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
What in the world is all this talk about sacrifice? Sins. Sacrifice for sins. Perfected, sanctified. Who needs any of this? Yes. This might be the reaction to this passage that conveys some of the basics of our faith. Reaction from the very people that we're trying to reach out to. And this reaction might seem hard to hear for those of us raised reading passages like this. Who can make them roll off of our tongues without feeling any need to think about what they might mean in the world of increasing doubt and skepticism, if not outright hostility? Many of us insist that sacrifice for sins is the only truly Christian way to understand Christ. No imitation of Christ, no moral model, but sacrifice for sins. Period. Full stop. Thank you very much. Nevertheless, there are even faithful Christians who might find these concepts outmoded. And of course, in the secular world, there's doubters, modernists, skeptics, postmodernists. They find some of these expressions laughable. The notion of sacrifice seems to have a bad reputation today. There are many reasons in and out of the church why it may seem strange to talk about sacrifices that can never take away sins. And Jesus making for all time a single sacrifice for sins. Strange even to some in the church, and especially to secular folk whom we need to reach if the church is going to survive. Ultimately, of course, the church's survival is not in our hands. Strange news to some people. It's not in our hands. It's in God's hands. As is conversion, and what is embedded in the talk of sacrifice addresses that reality. For all that, this passage still seems dated. What shall we make out of it? Is this simply dogma? Something we must profess whether we believe it or not? Cajole, browbeat others who would join us to do so as well? Or does this passage give expression to something real, if hidden, something we will inevitably stumble over as we walk through our faith? One commentator, George Wesley Buchanan, wrote a homily, Midrash, I'll explain those words in a minute, based on Psalms 110. Homiletic means that the letter was meant to be a sermon. And a sermon's purpose, one of them anyway, might be to answer a pressing question. And the word midrash was a means of debating used by rabbis before, during, and after the time of Jesus in the early church. Midrash creatively employs texts taken from Scripture and using these proof texts, interpreting them, in some way, people say twisting them, but it was a standard practice in the day. And to be honest, it's still standard practice for some people even today, to take Scripture and twist it. We do it all the time, even if we may call it by a name other than midrash or rash. We take text out of context, and we twist them and we bend them to suit our needs. The same commentator puts this in the context of a letter to the Hebrews. Midrashic composers were resourceful apologetics with amazing skill in manipulating words, phrases, and passages to suit their own needs. They were far removed from the original meaning of the text. They were primarily dogmatic theologians who used Scripture to prove the points that they wanted to defend. And again, the person saying all of this is George Wesley Buchanan. Well, why did they do this? Because their Scriptures were considered their sole means of authority. Human logic, human reason is terribly fallible. Scripture was seen as the definite, definitive word from the Lord. The sole means of offering vision as to the plans and the will of God. What we have in this letter here in Hebrews is a sermon using a passage that comes from Psalms 110 as a basis for declaring to its audience words of hope and words of encouragement. So Psalm 110, sacred scripture, lies in the background of what the author of Hebrews is trying to say in our passage today. The first verse of Psalm 110 reads, "The Lord says to my Lord," the first word Lord is capitalized, "sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Now, the psalm was considered to be a poem, and we know that a lot of the psalms was written by David. In Psalm 110, David is quoted as saying, The Lord says to my Lord. If God is the Lord that David is referring to, then who is David referring to when he says my Lord in the second term? Jesus raises the same question himself in Mark 12 verses 36 and 37. Indirectly, the author of Hebrews says in our passage for today that the my Lord being referred to here in Psalms 110 is Christ. He makes the point in verse 12 and 13 by midrashic interpretation of the words of Psalm 110 that Christ is the one who sits at the right hand of God and will have his enemies as a footstool. So, as the author of Hebrews reads Psalm 110, the Lord God is saying to Christ, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Hebrew author is saying that Psalm 110 points directly and only to Christ. And Jesus Christ is none other than the expected Messiah. He is linked to David's line by physical birth, but he's none other than the Son of God. The Hebrews author goes on to say, in one address to the Psalm by David, as my Lord is also a priest. And not just another priest in Aaron's line of succession, but a priest forever, the only priest that you or I will ever need. What did priests do back then? They presided over the offering of sacrifices, literally blood sacrifices of lambs and goats and bulls and birds, offered up daily, and considered sacrifices of atonement to appease an angry God for the sin of the people. The author of Hebrews is arguing that these sacrifices offered in the temple day after day are no longer effective. They don't do what they claim to do. They do not remove sin. They do not put those who offer them in the right relationship with God. They don't save. They never did. They were but a foreshadowing of the one sacrifice that did, that does save. The one sacrifice offered once for all time by the one who was both priest and sacrifice. Jesus. Jesus is the sacrifice. On the cross is the one through whom God's forgiveness lands directly upon you and me. Jesus is the sacrifice offered once for all time that perfects us in the eyes of God. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is the one that makes us right with God. Amen. This homiletic midrash was no doubt an effective sermon for those still enthralled to temple sacrifice and its demands while trying to establish a new understanding of faith with Jesus at its core. But what does it say to you and me today? What does this passage tell us? What Jesus shows us, sacrifice, forgiveness. Are we talking about some kind of human sacrifice? Is God not allowed to forgive until someone gets a throat cut? Are we supposed to feel better if that someone was God's own son? And what shall we say? What does it say to those in the world who see ourselves and themselves as not needing any forgiveness from God or from anyone else. For by a single offering, Christ has perfected for all time those who are sanctified, the Hebrews writer says. This is the claim that engages us today. It's the claim as bold now as it was in the early days of the church, when it began to identify itself as a separate entity no longer bound by temple ritual. It's a claim as bold today as its assertion of accessibility, of perfection, of a perfectly right relationship with God. We are in a right relationship with God, Hebrews says, then and now. And we can be assured of that perfect right relationship precisely because in Christ, God has done this for us. Understand, Christ's death on the cross, however you will, a sacrifice for sin, a triumph over the power of death, a model of faith lived out perfectly, the price of confronting evil. But however you do it, it was a deliberate action of God that altered forever our standing before God. Because of what happened on the cross, we are in a right relationship with God now and forever. And all we have to do is just reach out and accept it. On the cross, God showed the world once and for all that God does not hold our sins or our evil against us. Yes, acknowledge it or not, our sins are many, our evil manifold. God holds none of this without retaliating and overcoming our death dealing, and returns to lead us into a new day. What shall we do? First off, you and I need to love God with the gratitude that can only be shown to one who has saved our lives forever. And then extend that love to the world around us, to friends, to family, to church members, to seculars, to atheists, to enemies, to everybody, especially to those who suffer the world's cruelty, as Jesus did on the cross. May it begin with you and with me. Let us pray. Lord, help us to reach out and share God's love with others. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our closing hymn today is Marching to Zion, 733. Let us stand as we're able. 733.